involved there, and they were working with nuclear magnetic imaging, and they were using computers as well, and they were coming up with new technologies, as I said, not only winning the Nobel Prize, but completely changing the world of medicine as we know it today. I'll also invoke somebody else, as Dave said. I'm studied at the University of North Carolina at Chapel Hill, and since I'm talking to an IEEE crowd, I know a great many of you would probably know this next gentleman. This next gentleman is Frederick Brooks. For those of you who don't know Frederick P. Brooks, he is perhaps the most decorated computer scientist of our time. He is the winner of the National Medal of Technology. I could enumerate his history, his CV, for on and on and on and on. But when they gave him the Newell Award, the Association for Computing Machinery gave him the Newell Award in 1994, we thought he would never get the Turing Award. But ACM gave him the Turing Award 5 years after that. So when Dr. Fred says things to me, I listen very, very carefully. And in a personal conversation, he stated that he was blessed to have a career, to have been in the right place at the right time, to have studied operating systems and computer architecture, computer science, and computer graphics, and did molecular models and did other things. But when I asked him, what are the careers looking like for the next century? He told me that the most promising opportunities that lie in career development today lie at the intersection of computing and biology or biomedicine. And that'll be the thesis for my talk today. Some of you heard me speak this afternoon. I'll repeat myself a little bit on how I give a talk. I was told a long time ago, when you're teaching somebody, tell them what you're going to tell them, and then tell them what you told them. So this is what I'm going to tell you today. The thesis is that we're going to explore different areas of the intersection of computing and biomedicine, and through three different cases, one of which is the Visible Human Project that Dave was mentioning. And start with a very important observation to all of you. What is this? Microscope. It's a microscope, right? You know what's the funny about this microscope? It doesn't look very different from this microscope. That's Robert Hooke's original microscope from the 17th century. It's a compound microscope. Leeuwenhoek made a single element microscope. This is a compound microscope. The light focusing elements, the mirrors, the other things that you see there, are very unchanged pretty much for generations, for decades, for centuries. In the 1950s, Siemens made the following microscope. This is a transmission electron microscope, because the wavelengths of electrons are so much smaller than the wavelength of light, we can resolve much, much smaller things. But this is not what modern instruments look like today. Modern instruments look like this. That is an imperial microscope. You take your slides and you don't put them down and you don't scan back and forth through them. You stack them up in a magazine, you press a button, you go have coffee, you come back later, and all the pre-scanned slides are now sitting in your computer. This is what a scanning electron microscope, not transmission, but a scanning electron microscope looks like from Zeiss today. It doesn't look like I'm sitting there operating the dials and buttons and other things. Again, I load a magazine full of samples. I press a button. I start it up. I go get coffee. Okay, I babysit the machine, honestly, so I can scan all of this stuff. And I go through the data later on a computer. The change of instrumentation here that I'm trying to point out to you is that the computer itself has become the primary instrument of discovery. I don't sit in front of my microscope and twiddle it and fiddle it and look at all sorts of things. I sit in front of my computer at the data that's been collected, and I study that instead. We are no longer looking at our X-ray machines. We are pulling up the X-ray files from our radiology departments on our PAC systems, on our computers, on our web browsers, and doing all of our analysis from there. This is a fundamental change. That means that if you're a physicist, you know how to have to know how to use a computer, how to employ it, and how to deploy it in your research. So I'd like to go through the three cases to give you some idea of where we've been, where we're going, and project for you from where we've been, where you want to be in 10 years, when you graduate from college, when you're thinking about what your career should look like. I'll start with a visible human project. This is a project that was started 25 years ago. That was well before the high school students were born. 25 years ago, we conceived the idea that, let's start with this. This is what happened 25 years ago, and let me see if it plays for me.
This is the CBS Evening News with Dan Rather in Washington and Connie Chung in New York.
Good evening. A killer executed in Texas a year and a half ago now has a permanent afterlife in computer cyberspace. Joseph Jernigan left his body to science, and the National Library of Medicine today showed off the results. Jernigan's body was scanned top to bottom, front to back, and inside out to produce the first ever three-dimensional computerized cadaver. Medical students can use it to learn anatomy and to practice simulated surgery.
So by far, one of the most expensive parts of medical education is the gross anatomy class. And so the ability to scan a single subject, a cadaver in this case, and make it available for all, for posterity, for all education gross anatomy, was a triumph of digital science at the time. Shut up. So, but this was part of the long-range plan. It was a lot more, it was coming for a lot longer than just 25 years ago. In 1986, now today we think about digital imaging. I've got on my phone the capacity of holding 128 gigabytes of data. I've got a 21 megapixel camera or something amazing like that in my phone. And I can haul around all kinds of images. And these days, we don't think very hard. Set your Wayback Machines for the people who were around in 1986. We don't think very hard about the image formats that we use today. There's GIF, there's TIFF, there's PNG, there's, MP4. And you go on and on and on and on. You can come up with all these. In 1986, there were two, and they were bad. So a lot of information had to be synthesized, a lot of engineering had to be done just to come up with things like image file formats and compression and everything else to make this happen. And yet the regents of the National Library of Medicine said we should undertake whatever it's going to take, the feasibility, technical requirements for building image libraries. Today, we got YouTube. We've got all kinds of things at our disposal. But back then, this was quite pioneering. This is how it was done. We made a contract to the University of Colorado at Denver, and they built a machine, a macrotome. If you see this device here, you see those teeth on that rotating wheel. It's capable of cutting through a block of ice. The subjects were embedded in ice, and they were planed off 1 millimeter at a time for the male, 1/3 of a millimeter time for the female. If the male is about 2 meters tall, that's 2,000 images of the inside of a human being that were required. This is the most exhaustive, most complete anatomical study ever undertaken by anyone in the world. And this is what it looks like when they do it. Well, it does when it plays. And it's not playing. Yeah, that's too bad. It's an interesting sequence where they show how they slice through the segment and they photograph with a digital camera the exposed sections. Nevertheless, we not only imaged them with cryosection, the cryomacrotome, we also acquired MRI images, T1 and T2 weighted images, the proton density images, and X-ray CT scans. And all of that information can be synthesized together to bring us not just the anatomy, but the radiology that accompanies the same anatomy, what it looks like in gross anatomy, but also what it might look like in under radiological conditions. It is a full body scan. When we talk about putting this up on a display about this size, you've seen this screen right here, it's like, wow, that's a large scale display. Nope. That's a full scale display. The subject is 2 meters tall. I'm finally seeing my data, in fact, in about the size that he should have been when he was alive. It was hailed as a a remarkable accomplishment. We made the cover of Life magazine. We did not make the cover of Time magazine. We are not person of the week, but we did make the cover of Life magazine back then. But it also, when you get put a, in 1989, when you put a single 17 gigabyte data set out there, it would be the same thing as putting out a single 25 terabyte data set out today. It's a huge data set for the machines at the time. And it spurred an awful lot of computer science research and rendering, visualization, education, pedagogy, design, even some of the artistic aspects of this, trying to mimic the work by Da Vinci and Leonardo and other people when they were trying to illustrate, to do scientific and medical illustration at the time. It really was a grand time for us. In computer graphics and visualization. We finally had the data. We finally had the data we wanted in order to enable our research. But as Dr. Holmes pointed out, these are mostly 2D pictures that we've done. And all the software that was being developed, the Voxelmann software was proprietary to the Technical University of Hamburg. And it seemed important for us to be able to extract from those two-dimensional images the three-dimensional structures that we were looking for. And so in 1998, we launched a software development project, which became later known as the Insight Toolkit. This is a 20-year software development project. For those of you who haven't thought about it, most of our software doesn't last that long without a commercial enterprise. This is open source software. Anybody can download it. This is the way we spur open science. This is the way we spur innovation and development. At one point, I had as many as 50 software developers from all across the country. The Mayo Clinic was included. We had companies, GE. We had small companies, Cosmos, Kitware. We had engineering schools and medical schools involved. And we pulled it all together in order to do everything from radiation treatment planning to interventional surgery. Over 20 years, after the first 10 years, Obama took office and started a stimulus program because, for those of you who are alive, we were in a great recession. And I stuck my hand up and I said, I've got a project. I've got a shovel-ready project. I got shovel-ready software. 10-year-old software has to be, have to have a major release for that. And so we fired up ITK version 4, and they gave us $5 million to retool the software to bring it into the 21st century. So our favorite people, the Mayo Clinic, are right there in the middle. But there's, like I said, a variety of different groups that we brought together to bring this all to bear. 25 years later, over 4,000 licenses of the same data set. Those are the ones we know about in 66 countries. People have used it for everything from trauma modeling. They're still using it today for anatomical engineering. And I hope this one plays.
Like the fighter?
Yep, there we go. This is a collaboration with the electrical and computer engineering department at Rutgers University.
Thank you. Bye.
So it's all very interesting, you know, but we've all seen zombies before. Where's it all going? Where did it go from there? What does the future hold? I told you that I would not only tell you about the technology, I would try to tell you about Project Forward. This is work that we did with that self-same software, but we went down at least four orders of magnitude beyond the third of a millimeter we were looking at before. This is a graphic sort of description of how the visible human data was collected. You mill off a surface mill off of about a millimeter or a third of a millimeter, 333 microns, and then you photograph the exposed surface. That scanning electron microscope I was talking to you about before is actually an ion abrasion scanning electron microscope. It includes two different beams. One of the beams is a gallium ion beam that is capable of carving through a sample, and the second beam is the scanning electron beam that we can use as a photo, basically to take images. Yes?
How'd they cut it so well?
How did they cut it so well?
Yeah.
It took them a long time to figure out. It's not actually the cutting that's so difficult. That wheel that they were using, I wish I had the video to show you how the wheel is moving, it's got like 70 teeth, and it's moving at, I don't know, several hundred RPM in order to make a really, really fine cut through the material. It's in a block of ice, so the ice is just basically being shaved on every level. What you really need to ask yourself is not how do they cut it. When you take a block of ice that's about, 60 centimeters, a third of a meter by about a meter by about another meter, how much does that weigh?
I don't know.
Hundreds of pounds, right? And you're moving it underneath this cutting device, and you're going to stop it with a third of a millimeter precision underneath your camera so you can take the picture over and over and over again. Stopping 400 pounds of ice within a third of a millimeter over and over and over again is a remarkable feat of mechanical engineering precision, trust me.
I feel like I'm back in physics.
So there's an awful lot of work that goes into this. You think that the digital work is hard enough. Just moving blocks of ice and parking them underneath your cameras at the same place over and over again is remarkably difficult all by itself. You want to know about cutting so well? This one's even harder. Imagine you take a single cell, a macrophage, one of your leukocytes, one of the white blood cells in your body. This one's chronically infected with HIV. The question is the HIV, are the viruses swimming around inside the cytoplasm, or are they hiding in pockets, or are they sequestered in various places? Where are they stored? Where are the reservoirs of the pathogens? So they take the macrophage, they embed it in resin, and then using a focused gallium ion beam, they carve through the material 5 nanometers at a time. That's 5 to the 10 to the minus 9 meters, really small. I can try to give you an example of what that means. Carve through it, and then because the wavelengths are so short, use a scanning electron microscope as nothing more than a camera to try and image the exposed surfaces. So I've gone from visible humans now to visible cells. Using that self-same ITK software that we were using before, we were able to do analysis on this. Sriram Subramaniam was the scientist at the Cancer Research Center and said, can you find the viruses for us? And it's like, oh, easy. They're spheres. How big are they? They're about 11 nanometers, or, you know, so many. It's like, okay, we'll make a little sphere-finding program, and we were able to extract out, as you see, the red virions that are in that display, and it was done in three dimensions. And as you can see from this image, there are, in fact, pockets where the virions are hiding. They are not spread throughout the cytoplasm, and those pockets communicate with one another through these channels that are open. Yes?
Wait, so is that cancer or HIV?
HIV. It was the Cancer Research Center, but the Laboratory of Cell Biology, and they were studying HIV. Viruses do cause cancer. The human papillomavirus, for instance, is a cancer-causing agent, so a pathogen. So this, in this case, they're mostly studying the viruses, but the HIV is an important one to study. One of the things that we were very interested to note is that in some cases there are filopodia. That's your cell sends out a finger-like process. But we were also noticing that this macrophage is putting out these wave-like processes, and it made perfect sense to us when we saw it, because if you're trying to catch a ping pong ball, you don't use two fingers, you use your whole hand. And if you're trying to catch pathogens and things like that, you might erupt with these whole waves to reach out and scoop out through the fluid, through whatever, and collect the pathogens. For those of you who are radiologists, here's another approach to doing that kind of work. Instead of doing the destructive image sectioning, what they are capable of doing these days is using a transmission electron microscope, take a grid, and put the virus samples on the grid, and then tip the grid back and forth. Now, you can't tip it back and forth 180 degrees, but you can tip it back and forth about plus or minus 70 degrees. And using a plus or minus 70 degree rotation, you can do tomographic imaging of individual viruses. So these are 3D scans here of those viruses. And if you do a 3D reconstruction of that, this is more or less what it looks like. That's an HIV virus with a capsid inside with the RNA or DNA packed into the capsid inside. The bad boys that I want you to be looking at, though, on the outside are the glycoprotein spikes. Those glycoprotein spikes are absolutely essential to the infectious nature of HIV. If you take that virus and mechanically or chemically excoriate the protein, glycoprotein spikes off the outside, the virus is no longer infectious.
What?
The only way that that virus can enter a cell is by using those spikes to glom onto the outside of the membrane and zip open the membrane in order to invade a cell. You can take those spikes off the outside and that leave the remaining viruses swimming around with T cells all day long, and they will not infect the T cells. So there's something extremely important about those glycoproteins. Yes?
What are T cells? Are those just normal cells?
In your immune system, there are macrophages, leukocytes, white blood cells that go around and eating bugs, for instance.
Are those T-cells, white blood cells?
No, T-cells are part of your immune system. After the white blood cell captures the pathogens, the viruses, it undergoes a process called lysis where they break apart, kill the pathogens. With HIV, they don't kill the pathogens. The pathogens are, the viruses are resistant to lysis. They don't get broken up into parts. What the T cells do is the macrophages, the dendritic cells, whatever it is, the leukocytes, move over to the T cells, and they vomit off up all of the parts of the broken up cells to the T cell and say, here's what I found. And it's really gross. Help me find more of them. And the T cell uses the broken up proteins and things like that and generates antigens that it can then spread throughout the system. These are like flags that attach to the proteins that you find on the pathogens, making it much easier for the white blood cells to find the bad guys, the pathogens that are out there. So the T cells are basically the directors of your immune system. And unfortunately, what happens when a white blood cell or a macrophage is infected with HIV and doesn't incapacitate the HIV before it presents it to the T cell, it infects the T cell. It brings the live virus over to the T cell and infects the T cell. So what we're trying to understand is, what are the structures of those glycoprotein spikes? Because those glycoprotein spikes, since they're essential for the infectious nature of the virus, they are also a target for new therapies, new drugs for preventing the infectious nature of the disease. So through some careful reconstruction, we were able to, using those models, we were able to reconstruct not just the GP120 models on the outside, but this was later results, that spiral structure on the inside, that's the backbone of the GP1, the glycoprotein spike. So we want to invalidate or break apart either the backbone or to find a ligand to glom on to the end of the glycoprotein spikes. So using the software we had originally developed for a macroscopic gross anatomy, we are now looking at structures on the order of a dozen or so angstroms to try to find out what they look like and how they're working. So let me move on from the Visible Human Project to some other work that we've been doing, but not just us. There's an awful lot of this work that's being done right here at the Mayo Clinic. I'm going to talk to you a little bit about 3D print exchange. But mostly I'm going to talk to you mostly about the structure or the promise that 3D printing holds for us today. I don't know how many of you have worked with 3D printing, but Dr. Holmes has. And of course, working on the Visible Human Project, the first thing I ever did was I printed the Visible Human. And so that's a, I'm passing around a small model. I use visible 3D printing not for manufacturing so much, but I use it for visualization. And so the printers we bought were capable of printing in multiple colors, in a large palette of multiple colors, so that we can end up drawing these things. This was one of the first forays that I ever undertook in 3D printing. My boss said, yeah, you can't have a 3D printer until you show me what you can do with it. You could do research with it. And so in around the year 2000, we said, we can look at trying to do medical procedures with 3D printing. What I'm trying to portray right here in these graphics come from 20 years ago, Jonathan Morris, who is now a practicing radiologist here at the Mayo Clinic, was an intern in my department. We made a 3D, three-dimensional workstation to try and come up with a tool for helping people drill holes in people's backs. This is a sawbones model that is trying to show you that as you age, if you have disc compression, if the compression of the discs in your lower back fail, you get herniation of these discs, they press on your spinal cord, you might have to put in to do a surgery to decompress the spine, open up this channel, which is this cavity right here, so that the spine is no longer compressed. But if the back continues to compress itself, there's no way to put a cast or a splint around the back. So instead, we put this hardware, these furniture in here. What I'm trying to portray for you in those images is that there are these isthmuses of bone that transverse from the transverse process, the spinous process, to the vertebral body here. They're called pedicles. And in order to put all this hardware in there, we need to transect those pedicles with pedicle screws. Got to be a little careful, though, because if you miss, you can go through the spinal column or the spinal cord. If you breach the underside, I should go back. If you breach the underside, there's an abdominal aorta that could be, you could nick the abdominal aorta, creating tremendous problems for the patient in the middle of surgery. And if you enter the inner vertebral spaces, if you enter the discs, you give this poor person chronic arthritis in their back, in their lower back, you've actually compounded the problem, made it even worse. When I need to drill a precise hole when I'm woodworking, I make myself a jig, and I use that jig to prevent myself from drilling in the wrong place. So we made custom surgical blocks, surgical templates, with the particular trajectories that we wanted to go through those pedicles. Using a med modeler from Stratasys, which is a company that was here in Minnesota, and using a plastic that we knew that we could sterilize, we made these blocks, and Jay at his kitchen table took a drill bit, and he drilled into that particular vertebra right there. We took it to a CT scanner, and we showed you how you could drop in a couple of pipettes filled with barium, and they showed that we hit the, he called this the money shot. We transected the pedicles. We did not breach the underside of the vertebra. We put the screws exactly where we wanted them. This is 20 years ago. What are people doing with 3D printing today? What does a virus look like? Well, I just showed you. It looks sort of spherical and kind of spiky. And you know, it's kind of spherical and kind of spiky. I like this model in particular. It's this Hoberman sphere. It's purple, but it has this sort of, I told you the spikes were the infectious part of the virus. And I thought, you know, those are this day glow in the dark sort of green thing is one of the things I want you to think about as being sort of virulent. This is the other thing that you don't know about viruses. This is also what they look like.
I was going to say, it looks like one of those balls that explodes.
Yeah, it's one of those balls that explodes. Notice the symmetry? Notice the pentagons and the triangles and everything else that goes into this. There's a lot of structure that goes into this. It turns out that there's a lot of structure that go into viruses as well. Let me pass that around if you want.
Yes, sir.
So, backing up a little bit, this is work that we did in 2009. Somebody told me, printing 3D for visualization is great, but everything has to be still. And I said, no, you can animate this stuff. Go back. Trust me, you can animate this stuff. And the guy didn't believe me. And this is sort of a bar bet gone wrong. I went ahead and decided you could actually, you could make a 3D animation. And we built this cryosectionoscope in my garage. And I animated that visible human sequence you saw from Rutgers University. I put it on 3D models and we put it into this sequence. That's like an 1865 device called a cryosectionoscope. We used it in 3D models. It's a great parlor tool.
But let's get back to what viruses look like. The poliovirus was studied in great detail in the 1980s, and they came up with the structure of the poliovirus. What you see on the left up there is a two-dimensional transmission electron microscopic scan of the poliovirus. What you're seeing on the right there is a 3D construction of the poliovirus. You can see some of the pentagons that are in there, some of the triangles that are in there, but they're really somewhat hard to see. This is an animation, on the other hand, by Art Olson at Scripps Institute of the poliovirus. And they go through the animation. This is circa 1984, so it's kind of, you know, weird. But they start to highlight the mathematical symmetries that you're seeing there. They're highlighting one of the pentagonal structures. By the way, they have no imagination either. There are four proteins that go into this, VP1, VP2, and VP3, and VP4. Which stands for viral protein 1, 2, and 3, and 4. They can't come up with better names. The three on the outside are red. The one on the inside is green. You can't see the one on the inside. But if you take it apart and you print it, this is what it looks like. And there, you can open it up with your hands and see the structure. You can see the pentagons and other things. Let me go ahead and talk a little bit about nanotechnology, briefly. One of the hallmarks of nanotechnology is that, let me ask you, I've got this little tiny virus, and all it has is a little bit of DNA or RNA. And I can figure out how the DNA and RNA goes into the cell and hijacks the cellular apparatus to make more proteins, some of these protein coats, these pentagons and things like that that are on the outside. But how does it assemble itself? How does it work on hijack all the rest of the cellular apparatus that causes it to assemble itself? The postulate is that nanostructures are self-assembling. We're going to use nanotechnology, and it should be self-assembling, like crystals forming, like growing crystals. Can that be done? Art Olson and his team came up with this demonstration, and I hope it works.
Utilizing solid printed models of virus components and magnets representing the attractive forces between them, we can produce a physical analog capable of self-assembly by random shaking. The model demonstrates not only how nature accomplishes this feat, but can show some of the subtle characteristics of stochastic assembly. Notice that the subassemblies form and break apart en route to the most stable structure. The strength of the shaking is analogous to the temperature of the molecular environment. If it's too hot, the virus will break apart. If it is in the proper range, assembly will take place at an optimal pace.
I'm not sure you caught all the details of what he said. The strength of the shaking is analogous to the temperature of the molecular environment that it's in, which might explain why you have a fever when you have an infection, that it's trying to prevent the self-assembly of various structures, molecular structures, for instance. So moving on from that, one of the things that we noticed at NIH was that there are insufficient curated models that are going on out there. Yeah, you can go to Thingiverse and you can download a new iPhone case, but it's hard to come up with a self-printing, a printable 3D model of something that you might actually want to print or teach from. So in the mid-2014, 2015, we got funding from the National Institutes of Health and from the Department of Health and Human Services to launch the NIH 3D Print Exchange. We meant for it to be a sort of site where you could go shopping for curated three-dimensional models, download them. By shop, I mean actually go out and try them out, view them in three dimensions before downloading them, so you know what you're going to buy before you print before you go into it. And so this is the sort of interface, the web interface that we were working on to develop this. We had collaborations with a great many other people in this. We have a service in the 3D Print Exchange that if you send us your CT scan, we'll turn it into a 3D model that you can download again. If you wanted to pull up a model like superoxide dismutase, you only had to learn it up, look it up out of the protein data bank, give the accession number to the 3D print exchange. We'd make a 3D printable model. We'd notify you by email when your model was ready, and we'd mail it to you. By far, one of my favorite collaborations, though, was with the Enable group. What you're seeing here is that these are kids who have some sort of deficit, sometimes congenital deficit of their hands, where they don't have fingers, but they have some wrist articulation, and we want to print them artificial hands. We don't print them for them, but we want to make sure that the artificial hands were available, the prostheses were available, the models for the prostheses were available for free out in the world. One of the stories that comes from this is that there was an all-girl high school in Kentucky that was studying AP computer science, and they got a 3D printer. And they wanted to do as one of their projects with a 3D printer for their senior year, they wanted to print a hand for somebody else, for a young person. Some of these prosthetics can cost as much as $40,000, certainly $10,000. A 3D printed prosthetic costs about $500. And so they went out of their way. One of the best uses of social media that I've ever heard, if you had a 3D printer and you were willing to print somebody a hand, put yourself on the map. If you have a child who needs a 3D printed hand, put yourself on the map. And this school, I think in Danville, Kentucky, was able to find a patient in a neighboring county and print this person a hand. And he asked, thank you very much, but could it have Wolverine claws? So they added Wolverine claws for this patient. And just think for a moment. This child has been walking around with his hand in his pocket his whole life because he doesn't want people to see. And now he has the prosthetic, and it has Wolverine claws. Well, we didn't turn him into a superhero, but by God, we made his life different. Okay. There was a print-a-thon at the at Johns Hopkins University where they invited all these people to come with their 3D printers and make parts in different sizes to make a stock of these hands for a bunch of kids. One of the pictures that you saw down before, below was a child wanted to hold a sword. Double-handed lightsaber, right? Problem with some of these hands is that they can't grip a sword. It's not hard enough. His father was a HVAC engineer, went out and bought a 3D printer, and he made a hand with two thumbs, which could grip the sword the sword that he was holding so that he could wield his lightsabers with both hands. So not only are we putting out these files, but we're putting them out in a form that other people can modify and bring along. Where's it going? This is a picture of Jennifer Lewis. Jennifer Lewis is at Harvard University. She works in Northwest Labs. My office when I was there for 1 year, one academic year, was right across the street, or right across the hallway from mine. And so I spent a little time talking to Jennifer about this. That's a nephron she's printed. You know, she's printed about this size. You can see her holding it. A nephron, what's a nephron? A nephron is the little bit of tubing that's in your kidney that allows you to expel, uric acid and other things out of your body. How many of them you have? 1 million per kidney, right? That's a pretty big nephron, and if I made 1 million of them, you'd have to carry it around in a pickup truck. It's kind of hard right now. And so you got to ask yourself, what's the big deal? Well, she says in her in this article that, yeah, the first transistor was the size of a jelly jar. Okay, and it took us 40 years to make the Pentium 5, and it took 3 or 4 generations of technology to make that happen, but then we had 5.5 million transistors on a single chip, right? When we make those same leaps of faith, when we put ourselves to work and design manufacturing systems where we can make 1 million nephrons and something the size of, well, this, 40 years from now I'll be like 96, I'll need one, thank you. But we might be printing people organs by then. So let's move on. I don't have a lot of time, so let me move on quickly to computing for discovery. I want to talk to you a little bit about bioinformatics, the field of bioinformatics. If you don't like printing things and building things, if you don't like slicing up dead people or animating them again, I'd like to talk to you a little bit about bioinformatics. About 20 years ago, I arrived at the National Institutes of Health. And I didn't know anything about what I was doing. So they said, well, just, you know, go to the research festival. At the National Institute, at NIH, we have a research festival once a year where we put up a big tent, we put out posters, and we talk to each other. It'd be like your whole university or all of Mayo Clinic coming out with posters and talking to each other, telling each other what they were up to. One of the great things about that plenary session of that 1998 research festival was they were going to talk about the origins of life. Ooh. That sounds like a very accessible topic, and I might actually understand something about what they're doing. So the first guy gets up there and he talks about some of the early life forms on Earth were bacteria, and some of them excreted rock or minerals, and they made rock formations called stromatolites, which is fossilized remains of bacteria. Great, that's wonderful. Next guy comes up and Dan Golding, and he's talking, he's the head of NASA, and he says, what we really need to do is we need to, there's a canyon on Mars that's the length of the North American continent, and the entire geologic record of the planet is exposed at that point. What we need to do is we need to send a rover to Mars, and we need to go up to the edge of that canyon and send a package over the edge, and we need to, like, look at the geologic record. But we don't know anything about paleontology or anything like that, so you guys, you biologists, you gotta teach us something about that. Third guy gets up, it was Eugene Koonin from the National Library of Medicine, where I was working. I was very interested. And he said, I don't know anything about rocks. I don't know anything about rockets. What I do know a lot about is databases. And we have a database called GenBank, where we have all of the genomes that we've been able to collect, and at that time, about 50,000. Now we have about 5 million, but at that time, about 50,000 genomes. And we're scanning all the genomes to find out what they have in common, all the genes, the collections of genes for entire organisms. And we found 75 genes that are in common to every single partial or complete genome that we have in GenBank. Wait for it. And since it's in common to all of the life forms that we've been able to study, we believe that those 75 genes represent part of the primordial gene pool for the beginnings of life on Earth. I was astounded. These people are not biologists. And they don't run around with test tubes and things like that. They are computer scientists looking at databases in the basement of the air-conditioned offices, and they're making conjectures about the origins of life on Earth. That was astounding to me. We can go on and on and on. But the Stanford group in 2012 showed how you could simulate an entire cell, the life and death, birth and death of an entire cell, not a big cell, a bacterium, as a really modest beginning. But we can start simulating larger and larger life forms. Another hero of mine, Arthur Smith, he's won the Nobel Prize, shared the Nobel Prize for the knockout mouse with Mario Capecchi from the University of Utah. He came to speak at NIH. I was privileged to hear his talk. And he was talking about the time spent on learning how to simulate my experiments, and he changed that. He says, the time spent learning how to simulate your experiments with simple computer models will be well repaid, because the choices, the assumptions you have to make in order to make those models will teach you more about the science that you're trying to simulate than anything else. So this notion of simulation is huge. And if you think that it's only, you know, well, 7 years ago, well, just last month, I was at the University of Illinois Urbana-Champaign, and they were talking about this work that they had published in Cell magazine, I think, where they simulated a chromatophore, which is a organelle inside a purple bacteria, which takes sunlight and converts ADP to ATP directly rather than photosynthesis. It's not the process found in plants, but it's found in purple bacteria. And so here's a way of converting sunlight into energy biologically that wasn't otherwise known or understood. Here's one. The Human Genome Project came up with some 2,000 genes that you find in humans. And they started, the Cancer Institute was so excited about that, they started the Cancer Genome Project. And I said, geez, that's about as stupid as I can imagine, because cancers are mistakes. They're mutations, and they're mistakes in translation. Why would you want to catalog mistakes? Well, this just proves that I'm as stupid as a brick. You know, if I were typing Hamlet over and over and over again, and somebody started cataloging all the mistakes I made in transcribing Hamlet, it might not tell me anything about Hamlet, but it sure would tell me something about the typewriter. It would tell me what keys were next to, there you go, but it would tell you which keys, but that the A key is next to the S key because I kept on hitting the S instead of the A. I would start seeing transcription errors and where they arise. More importantly, the mistakes that happen to make a cancer are not just, well, most mutations are immediately lethal to the cell, it just dies. The mutations that cause the cell to translate itself into something potentially lethal to the organism make it immortal and then make it invasive. Those are multiple mutations. And if you can catalog how those mutations are interrelated, right, now we can understand how cancer works. This study came out in 2012. They were studying breast cancers, and they decided that they can catalog breast cancers into four different classes. And one of them is much more closely related to ovarian cancer than it is to the other three breast cancers. Think about that for a moment. This breast cancer we've been trying to treat in this patient has been highly resistant to the treatments, to the chemotherapies that we've been trying to use. And if you determined that it was more closely related to ovarian cancer, now we have a new drug target. And that drug target might be those chemotherapies we were using for ovarian cancer instead of, and it explains much. This story also came out in 2012, about that same time. This is the ENCODE data. The human genome, we came up with about 2,000 genes. Yeah? There were about 4 million other genes that we thought were junk. But when you study those 4 million genes very carefully, you realize that they are very, very closely and meticulously transcribed from generation to generation in your cells. Why? If they're junk, there should be mistakes all right throughout all of that DNA, through all of those genes. But they're not. So the speculation was they're important. We just don't know, they simply don't encode proteins. And this story came out, it took, and I got to get this right, 440 scientists and 32 laboratories across the world to encode all of the dark matter in our DNA. But if you think about the breakthroughs in physics and astrophysics that are going on right now that talk about dark matter, we have dark DNA that is now coming to light. And we are understanding that this is the valuable DNA that helps regulate our cellular processes, not just make us proteins, but regulate the life and death of our cells. So where am I going with this? None of this can be achieved without collaboration. It takes 32 laboratories. It takes 440 scientists. It takes all kinds of people from all across the world in order to make this happen. It takes computers. It takes databases. And it takes young people with an inspiration to do work in these areas. I said my thesis was the most promising opportunities today for career and professional development are at the intersection of biomedicine and computing. And I hope I've made my case for that, not just in looking backwards 25 years, but trying to project forward where that might lead us in the next 25 years. One of my other favorite heroes is Louis Pasteur, and this is one of his quotes, "Chance favors the prepared mind." And not the fumble fingers out there. So what do you need what do you need to study? What is the preparation you need to be part of this? Well, amazingly, you need to know something about math and geometry. You need to know something about computer science. Paul Lauterbur was a physicist, right? We need to know something about biology and material science if you're doing 3D printing, engineering, in art and design, because some of these things require that. Who do we need? We need nurses, we need doctors, we need engineers and programmers, scientists, inventors, entrepreneurs, and yes, designers, leaders, artists, writers, and poets. I come back to the first question I asked. Did you ask a good question today? Did you ask a good question today?
Yes, sir.
You asked about genomes. You asked about other things.
I was the only one.
What kinds of questions can we be asking in the next 25 years? How did life originate?
Thank you.
I said we lost Paul Lauterbur in the last 10 years. The last things that of his career that Paul was committing himself to was the origins of life. He was studying the origins of life. How do living things capture energy from the sun?
Synthesis. photosynthesis.
We're simulating that now with purple bacteria. How do we help a patient's immune system fight cancer? What advances do we need to print working artificial kidneys? If I can print, you know, one of the things that we do all the time is we give blood because nobody's made a decent synthetic blood yet. Can we print red blood cells? What will it take? These are our opportunities in the next century. I don't know. I don't know about the rest of us, but I see three people, young people down in the front that I'm hoping will be part of that revolution. All right. Thank you so much.
All right, maybe a couple questions if anyone has any. So maybe you could talk briefly about, you had mentioned collaboration and you had mentioned computers. Today we are so incredibly well connected. What's the future of collaboration look like? We are so connected. What are we going to be able to do in the future around collaboration and technology?
That's a really good question. And so my answer would be manifold. I mean, just the ability to connect with scientists. I mean, my son right now is in Hong Kong, and I can connect with him over the phone, and I can, you know, we can reach out and communicate with one another almost anywhere. So that's a simplistic answer. Let me give you a harder answer, right? In the past, one of the things that, the way we record our discoveries, the way we share them and communicate them to each other, is we write them down on papers, right? And if you can't make it, if you can do nothing more than put it in a 2D picture of something, everything has to be reduced to two dimensions in order to store it on a piece of paper or a PDF, a file, or something like that. But if my PhD thesis in chemical engineering was synthesizing a new petroleum, a new something, or a new enzyme, right? I don't have the enzyme anymore, just the paper recipe for creating the enzyme. Today, however, we have these computational models. We have these simulations. We have the ability to store the 3D print exchange as an example, where I can give you something which you can reproduce the three-dimensional artifact, right? So now our collaboration isn't just read about it. The collaboration can be you can make your own. And as this field continues to develop and grow, make your own nephron, make your own biological structure, print in biomaterials as well as something else. The idea of being able to cook up and synthesize and create proteins and other things as part of that collaborative structure. It's more than just paper now. We are in a new frontier for the next generation of scientists.
Awesome. Any other questions?
So the National Library of Medicine has an entire page on the visible human. If you want to download slices of the visible human, or the entire visible human, it is now available for free and without license, so you can download it. Go do a Google search on the Visible Human Project, and if you just visit www.nlm.nih.gov and do a search there on visible human, you'll be able to find almost all the anatomical information, including pages to the, say, 1,500 products that were derived from the visible human. You can probably find links to those as well.
All right, let's thank our speaker again. Okay, I